Okay. Any other, is that good? Okay, maybe that's too much info, but again, this mill thing is just like, it's the bane of everybody's. Okay, so there are a few other transmission lines that, so the analysis I'm gonna do or show you guys, okay? So again, we're first gonna analyze this from sort of like the brain dead circuitry theory point of view with resistors and inductors and capacitors, and then in 5 weeks' time, we'll do the same thing with Maxwell's equations and stuff. Okay, so we're doing that. So what I'm gonna do is really gonna apply to these kind of transmission lines, okay? What makes these special? They're all essentially two-wire transmission lines. There's always like two things going on. There's a signal and a ground, or two signals or something, so it's a two-wire transmission line. Okay? And I'll show you guys, like, our analysis today wouldn't cover like an antenna, because strictly speaking, there's no termination. This is also the analysis that we're doing is when you're having a source and a load, as you'll see what that means, source and a load. Okay, that would be Baramek and Tony, source and load. If there was no Tony and I was just wiggling that thing and it was kind of snapping all around, it would be more like an antenna and the analysis would be a little different. Okay, so I'm just telling you the limitations. If it was a fiber optic cable, it's still electromagnetic waves, but this sort of brain dead analysis that both, if you're doing Maxwell's equations, are kind of the same, but the brain dead analysis is different. Optics brain dead analysis has to do with index or refraction and reflection coefficients and these kinds. It's like ray optics. I don't know if you guys have studied optics, but it's like kind of the circuit analysis simplifications of Maxwell's equation. It's just a different set of Maxwell's equation type of thing. So it's kind of covering these things. By the way, I wanted to say one thing is like, when I'm saying this is a two-line transmission line, one type is two wires, right? You think like any two wires could be transmission line? It's only, strictly speaking, it's true, but not in the sense that we're talking about, because if the two wires, they have to be in this, the whole length, they have to be the same distance apart, okay? This has to be the same dielectric between them, otherwise our methodology for transmission lines won't work. It would be like having lots of different transmission lines in little sections of part of the time they're separated and part of the time together. Do you guys see what I'm saying? So, for example, inside this cable, so now you can guys think of this cable as an actual electrical cable. I don't know if you guys ever cut these things. I'm not gonna cut this today. I don't know, but what you guys typically see is like a braided line. You see stuff that's twisted, pair, or otherwise packed tightly in a controlled way. Okay, so that they can, so this happens. So regardless of what I'm doing here, I can't move these wires apart inside there. They're all the same, the whole length. Those two wires, the signal and the ground, they're all the same distance from each other inside this cable. That's why, part of the reason why it's like tightly wound like this, so I can't screw around with it too much. In fact, this was, you know, for some products, okay, when you have, this is like relatively slow, right? You can only put so much data through a USB cable, right? If this was, you know, if I had a cable that was doing high speed data communication, those will get, as you'll see, I don't know if you'll see it because it's not that common, but you'll see it only in specialized places. They get stiffer and stiffer, so I can't bend them like this either, okay? So they get stiffer and stiffer and stiffer and stiffer. Anyway, my point being that this two wire doesn't mean just any old two wires. They have to be the same distance in the whole of the transmission line that we're gonna analyze, because we're gonna sort of treat this as something that's like gonna have the same thing happening all along it. Okay? You guys with me?
Professor? Okay.
Yeah.
If you don't mind, do you go over the straight line again? I didn't get it.
This guy?
Yes.
Okay, so imagine if you had this printed circuit board, okay, that's multi-layer. So,
do you see why printed circuit boards are multi-layer? Why you would make them multi-layer?
No.
It's just because, imagine if you had highways and didn't have overpass bridges on highways. So you'd kind of like one highway would be running north-south, another highway would be running east-west, and that highway would get to this north-south highway, and like, what do I do now? So you have overpass bridges. So the more layers you have, or like, I don't know, if you've gone to like underground in like London or someplace like that, trains are like many, many layers down because trains are running. If you could do that, it'd be great. I don't know if you guys remember, like some people, I don't know if it was Elon Musk or somebody, was planning to have like elevated highways. It's just that it allows you to route signals, okay, through. And you can imagine like if you had a complex system like your cell phone, there's lots of thousands, maybe, I don't know, actually tens of thousands of wires running around. Okay, so you make them multi-layer just so you can route around. Okay, so does that make sense? Okay, so once you do that, the way you do that is you get a
like dielectric layer.
So because you want many layers, you don't want the metal lines to shorten between them, you have a bunch of these dielectric layers, which are usually like green. In that case, there's like red color where that printed circuit board. Okay, and then the metal lines are kind of in between. They don't have to be right over each other, but you get the idea. And then here. So this would be like a 5-layer board. Typically, they're even number of boards. Usually, you go to the manufacturer and say, I want a 6-layer board, so I'm going to draw a 6-layer board. Why it's even numbers, I don't know. But usually, that's what happens. And the more the number of layers, the more you'll pay for the board. So we're just making these things. So these are all fairly thin. So by the time you put all the 6 layers together, you'll end up, or whatever, you'll end up with something like that thick. Okay, so I can kind of imagine like roughly what, so this thickness may be, I don't know, like a millimeter and a half. So if this was 6 layers or 8 layers, maybe they're 100 micrometers apart from each other. Okay? So if you were gonna design a transmission line on this top layer or this really bottom layer, these are unique, right? They're not in the middle. So you only have one top layer and one bottom layer. What makes them different is that there's no dielectric here, there's only dielectric on one side. And same here, there's no dielectric here, there's like air here, right? And there's only dielectric on one side, okay? So if I was gonna make a transmission line here, I would put a metal plane here that I would use as a ground. Signal. Send you this. I'll make this thicker. This will be my ground. This will be my signal. That's how I would do it. If I was gonna make a transmission line here or here, okay, and that would be a microstrip. So a transmission line up here would be a microstrip, and a transmission line here would be. With me so far? Okay, now let's say I want to make a transmission line in here. I can't make that a microstrip because this piece of metal is surrounded on both top and bottom by the dielectric. Okay, so that's going to make look like a strip line. That's the only difference between. So what I would do is I'd use the same ground on here. I would make another ground. Would be a strip transmission. I just have to be because it'll have dielectric on both sides, just the way it's created.
Yeah.
So, based off your drawing, you have to have ground like on every other side of the copper wire.
If you do either one of those, strictly speaking, for I could make a coplanar. Oops. Yeah. I could make a coplanar and get away without a ground. So that would be the only way.
Is coplanar cheaper?
It might be. The thing is, like, the coplanar is making you bigger in this direction, okay? And the strip line and the microstrip are wasting space in this direction, so I don't know. It might be. Yeah. So typically, it's a material called FR4. I don't know what FR4 stands for, or it looks like some kind of a compressed epoxy to me, but like some kind of a fiber component. I'm just looking at it. And like that's very typical, is FR4. Okay? As you get fancier and fancier, the material might change, okay? At the real extremes of like high speed, blah blah blah, you could go to ceramics. So, but it's some kind of a dielectric, okay? And then one of the things I'm really not gonna talk about in our first description of a transmission line is something called, I'm gonna specifically leave it out, and I'm gonna tell you guys that I'm leaving it out again. So, because it's loss, okay? If there is, as we won't discuss it in this class ever, just for this lecture, at these kind of high speed at these frequencies, even a dielectric has some resistance across it. Okay, and what that does is it's making the transmission line lose amplitude, lose energy, depending on how fast the frequency that it's running at, and how far it's running, and so on. So like a ceramic has lower loss than FR4. FR4 is kind of meat potatoes, printed circuit board. It's not fancy. You can go get it here. It's not going to cost you too much. So by the way, just this is like extra information about printed circuit boards. So what they make them in panels, okay, and then they cut them. I don't know what they cut them, saw them. So when you go order a printed circuit board from a place, the cost depends on how big your board is, because then, and how many you want.